Hello everybody, welcome to the In a Nutshell video series. My name is Konstantinos Kyritopoulos and in this video we are talking about the critical path method. The critical path method has its origins back to 1940s, 1950s and it is used in order to predict the outcome of the duration of a project. The steps that one needs to do in order to complete the critical path method is first of all to define the activities involved in the project, their durations, and of course their dependencies. There are too many kind of networks used in CPMs, the activity on arrow and activity on node. Predominantly, nowadays, activity on node is used, and this is what we are talking about today. The simple example that I'm going to use concerns the engineering drawings for a house development. Of course, it's just an example and it will only entail 5 activities just for educational purposes. There are many ways of solving a CPM network and giving the answer to how long the project is going to last. I'm going to give you just one of them. The first thing that we need to do in order to make the CPM calculation is to define the problem. So quickly we get a table. We give an ID to all the activities. Say A, B, C. Let's suppose that the tasks, activities for our project are architectural drawings, structural drawings, mechanical electrical drawings, the site plan and the approval. We now have to estimate the duration. And of course, the predecessors, which means which activities should be completed before an activity can start. The algorithm that I'm going to show can handle finish to start activities, but can also handle lead and lag times. So for instance, the site plan can start as soon as the 75% of activity A is completed. The next step in the process is to design the network. First of all, because there are several notations for the critical path method networks, you should always have a drawing legend stating what exists in each one of your nodes. We're putting the starting node. And then the nodes of the activities. When a dependency is not clear, that is, it is not a complete finish to start dependency, it is always useful to keep a note that reminds you that only the 75% of activity A should be fulfilled before activity D starts. Now our network is ready. The next thing that we need to do is to fill in the nodes of our network with the duration of the activities. For all the activities that have a clear finish to start relationship, meaning without any lead or lag time, the DHA values will be equal to the duration of the predecessing activity. The DHA values is the time that should elapse between the start of a predecessor and the start of a successor activity. However, in case there is a lag or lead time, like in the relationship between activities A and D, the DHA value will differentiate for the duration of the predecessor activity. In this case, activity D can start as soon as the 75% of activity A is completed. This equals to 6. Supposing that the start of the project is at time 0, we can now do the calculations according to the formulas. So the early start of an activity A is the early start of its predecessor plus the DIJ value. So 0 plus 0 equals 0. Following the same pattern, we can get the early start of activities B, C, and D. In merging activities, which are activities with more than one predecessor, we are taking the maximum value of the early start plus the DIJ values for each one of the preceding activities. So, in this case, we have maximum of 11 plus 2 for the CE connection and 6 plus 3 for the DE connection. So the outcome is 13. And finally, we can calculate the total minimum duration of our project, which is 22 time units, days in this specific example. This was how we calculate the early start of each activity on our network. Now we are going to calculate the late start of each activity. We assume that the late start of the finish milestone is exactly the same as the early start, and we go backwards with exactly the opposite procedure. Now, from the late start of the successor activity, we deduce by the Dij value in order to come up with the late start of the preceding activity. In bursting activities, which are activities that have more than one successor, we take the minimum value from the calculation late start successor minus dij, where I is the preceding activity and j is the succession activity. In this case, we have the outcome is zero. Now we check all activities on our network and search for which of them the early start equals late start. These are activities A, B, C, E, and of course start and finish. These activities form the critical path of our network, meaning that any delay in each one of these activities will mean exactly the same delay in the overall project. So this was how the calculations of the critical path method works. I hope that you did get the basics, and for any queries, see you in class.